Hello, I'll just wait a couple of moments before starting while everyone joins us before we get going. I can see quite a few people coming into the webinar, so welcome everyone. Okay, great, I think we'll get going. Hello everyone, thank you so much for joining us and a warm welcome to day three of our unfolding online conference and workshop program, Cutting Edge, Collage in Britain, 1945 to now, which is presented collaboratively by the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art and Tate Britain. My name is Rosie Ram. I am a visiting lecturer in Curating Contemporary Art at the Royal College of Art. And alongside Sarah Turner, Deputy Director of the Paul Mellon Centre, and Elena Cripper, Curator of Modern and Contemporary British Art at Tate, I'm one of the co-conveners of this two-week event. Today, we are very excited to be able to present our second keynote and artist film presentation in a session that is entitled Collage as Method, Manuscript and Moving Image. Building upon the different strands of analysis and debate that have been emerging over the last 2 days, and which so many of you have contributed to with your thought-provoking questions and comments, I think today's session will even further enrich and nuance how we understand collage methodologically as a practice that might adopt different materialities and technologies in order to extend processes of visual inquiry across time and space. I think these two presentations will not only prompt us to consider questions around collecting, archiving, and conservation practices, but also how collage might mediate forms of communication, collectivized ways of working, and even cognition. Before I introduce our first chair for today, I just wanted to briefly recap on some general housekeeping points for this Zoom webinar format. We'll begin shortly with our first keynote presentation, which will be followed by a Q&A. We'll then take a short break. After that, I'll introduce our next presentation and the artist film will be screened, after which we'll close today's session with a further Q&A. Please do use the chat function on Zoom throughout these presentations. As we've mentioned, it's been so engaging to read your contributions and comments as the discussions have been unfolding. In the Q&A sections, please then use the separate questions box to post questions for our speakers, which will be read out by the chairs. These sessions are all being recorded and will be made available on the Paul Mellon Centre's website and YouTube channel. And if you'd like to enable closed captions, please use the CC button on your screen. I am delighted to now introduce our first chair for the day, Victoria Walsh, who is Professor of Art History and Curating at the Royal College of Art and head of the Curating Contemporary Art Programme. Victoria is a curator and researcher whose projects span from the post-war period to the contemporary. In 2014, she led the reconstruction of Richard Hamilton's 1951 exhibition, Growth and Form, for the major retrospective of the artist's work at Tate Modern and the Reign of Sophia, which built upon her previous experience reconstructing the 1953 exhibition, Parallel of Life and Art. In collaboration with Claire Zimmerman, who also joins us today, Victoria co-curated New Brutalist Image, 1949 to 1955 at Tate Britain, and together they published a photo article in British Art Studies in 2016, which both elucidates and it extends the research behind that Tate display. So I will now hand over to Victoria to introduce Claire Zimmerman, our first keynote for the day. Thank you so much for joining us, Claire and Victoria.
Thank you, Rosie. And first of all, thank you to all the staff of the Paul Mellon Centre. I know we all keep thanking, but it's an extraordinary thing to organise and wonderful for it to come to fruition after the last 2 years. It's a real pleasure for me to welcome and introduce Claire Zimmerman, Professor in Architectural History and Theory at the University of Michigan. I'm not sure how many time zones we're all straddling across this morning, but for Claire, it's very early. I think it's like 7 o'clock in the morning. So I think we'll see some paraphernalia of coffee cups, even if we can't smell it. I'm sure we're going to see it as we go through Claire's talk. I just wanted to sort of start by just briefly saying that Claire and I first met on the football fields of Hunstanton School, a building embedded, of course, in the history of New Brutalism and designed by Alison and Peter Smithson. But in particular, we were introduced by Soraya Smithson, daughter of Alison and Peter, and we began a conversation that led, as Rosie just indicated, to our collaboration, New Brutalist Image, 1949 to 54, which took place at Tate Britain. And this collaboration was particularly framed by Claire's interest in architecture and photography and architecture in relation to its cultural mediation. And she's published extensively on this. You've got her detailed biography on the website, but of particular note, there was the anti-photograph in 2019 and last year, anticipatory images. And for those of you not familiar with Claire's work, I would strongly recommend her publication from 2014, Photographic Architects in the 20th Century. When the call for this conference came about, it seemed the very perfect tautology, perfect context for Claire to introduce the extraordinary scrapbook compiled by Alison Smithson as a private source book. And when I say extraordinary, having seen and handled it with Claire, its precarious and fragile monumentality is quite remarkable. But as it is so fragile and inaccessible, and hopefully one day it will be digitized for wider audiences to be able to engage with, Claire's paper will offer us a really good opportunity and a unique opportunity and critical insight to the architectural and visual themes and concerns that Alison was exclusively on her own looking at. And I think that will generate a lot of questions from all of you to talk about at the end. And for those who joined yesterday's session with Ben Cranfield and Craig Buckley, I think there'll be some very productive connections to draw out. So without further delay, I'm going to hand over to Claire to get us underway for today.
Good morning. Can anyone see me or hear me?
Yes, you're from across the world, Claire.
Okay, great. So I'll share my screen and get going. First, though, I do want to say thank you to everyone there. Elena, Shauna, Danny, Rosie, Sarah, and also to especially thank Victoria. I would certainly not be here had she not alerted me to the opportunity and advocated, I'm sure, for me to present this work. It was so much fun working with Victoria that we simply allowed the project to drag out for like about 4 or 5 years even. And it's a scream to talk about that, but I'm gonna jump right in now and get going on today's material. I wanna start with two things today. One is an antique volume measuring roughly 12 by 16 by 6 that strains its binding to the breaking point, reinforced along the spine with a strip of animal fur. A great brick of a book, its 400 plus pages have been winnowed by cutting, but also thickened by the addition of part images cut or torn from product packaging, magazines, pamphlets, brochures and other books, or in the form of snapshots, postcards, and portraits. Its most recent inclusions, hastily attached or simply slipped between pages, belie the careful cutting and glued application of earlier interventions. just as blank spots and remnant smears of glue, whoops, we've jumped ahead a little bit, just as blank spots and remnant smears of glue mark the absence of images that had previously been added and later stripped away. These clues suggest a working catalog, a storage vehicle for changing images. They also suggest how things changed from the scrapbook's early days to the moments of its last editions, after which the book's architect, Alison Smithson, followed British antiquarian and publisher Charles Knight, the first author of the volume, into oblivion. The second object is an architectural description for a gallery, an art gallery, a building type that Alison Smithson described as a container for two kinds of occupants, viewers and objects to be viewed. She described, quote, a finely designed pipe for liquids, for two liquids, one coating but changed at intervals, the other flowing. In describing the necessary architectural conditions for an art gallery, the description of her university thesis project reflects an astonishing attention to detail, combined with rather sweeping claims about art perception, notable in a student aged only 21. Quote, to know a picture, you have to move past it at your leisure. The question of presentation is extremely delicate because of the variety of people using a gallery. Form in art is an affair of relationships, and it should be borne in mind while designing that each picture should be presented to bring out its full value and at the same time not break the harmony of the whole. Apart from this, because of the fundamental fact that exhibitions are an ever-changing kaleidoscope, the architectural form cannot be designed for a specific form of presentation. Contemporary suggestions for wall treatment include rough painted plaster, tinted cork, flexwood, textile coverings, parchment paper, and velvet. General requirements for textile coverings, one, must be closely woven and durable so as not to show marks of presentation. Two, should not contain wool to attract moths. Three, texture should be interesting enough to relieve monotony, but not diverting. Culture absorption can be explained by that theory which states that the visitor's retina must still hold some sensation of what he has just left. When no sensation is retained, the visitor is in need of rest and refreshment, of the opportunity to relax his eyes and sit down. All of this in the space of two pages. These two objects, a great scrapbook and the first of many highly detailed statements of design intent, organize my remarks today. An architect's practice described in words and a repository of architect's ideas stored in images. An architect's practice functioning in the immediate wake of war and rationing, yet with the fumes of American affluence wafting over post-war Britain. A woman practicing architecture in post-war Britain, simultaneously claiming past and present, thinking at big and small scale at once, yet working in and focused on a man's world, or to describe post-war British architecture more properly, a boy's club in which women trod a delicate line between decorousness and employment, even as they sought to consolidate the gains of the previous decades. And finally, a woman practicing architecture as the British Empire slipped into the past to become historical material. But before we get fully underway, a disclaimer. My work on Alison Smithson's working scrapbook has been interrupted by developments of the past 18 months. Today's remarks, therefore, must be preliminary. A willing response to the invitation to bring this work into view now, no matter how provisional my own thoughts still may be. My goal here is to situate one object, Smithson's working scrapbook, in relation to the other, her practice of architecture, and to map the contours of a fuller treatment of this unpublished work within histories of collage practice, international modernism, the post-war culture of the architectural profession, and women's place therein. Provisionally, what might the scrapbook tell us? About a woman working as an architect in the crucially restrictive and remarkably permissive decades of 1950s, 60s, 70s, and 80s Britain. What do we learn about an architectural practice founded on a call and response between past and present, a practice founded by Smithson and her husband and partner Peter, that was deeply founded in history, resolutely modern and modernist, but equally predicated on ambitions that did not run with the boys, as it were, as the decades unfurled. Zooming out yet further, the scrapbook reflects how internationalized image culture shifted from vestigial British or Euro-American imperialism to an emergent Cold War bilateralism in which the eastern half of Europe effectively went dark to those in the West, and former imperial territories became independent nation states bearing visible scars of colonial occupation. And you'll see that in some images coming up. The eye of the architect is depicted here, cast far afield from her home base in Old England to take in a newly global and post-colonial scene. To briefly consider the scrapbook under the rubric of collage, it might be related to similar objects of its day, from artist scrapbooks to collage works, but also to a longer history of bookmaking. It is collage, scrapbook, and pictorial narrative of post-war global culture, including architecture. But more insistently, it demonstrates a way of working that was enmeshed and networked. A connective worldview resonates in the frequent appearance of textiles and fabrics throughout its pages. And in textile metaphors that continued, that dominated the Smithson's practice more generally through lattices, mats, and patterns, their inheritance from the North, perhaps, and a recurring preoccupation of Allison's. The scrapbook also evokes what one might characterize as Allison's ambivalent, but nonetheless distinctive feminism, a byproduct of the age in which she lived. Some basic context to the gains made after World War I and World War II by women, the post-war years added and took away. British women, for example, could get the pill after 1961, but only if they were married. It became available to all women only in 1967. And for sort of scholarly context, like the work of Judith Henderson on working class family life, the sociologists Viola Klein and Alva Myrdal's Women's Two Roles, Home and Work of 1956, investigated women's working women's situation after the war, arguing that, quote, the home role should be done jointly by men and women, and that women's life cycles and life expectancy have been fundamentally changed by industrialization. The Smithson's decision to conduct their practice out of their home might be considered in light of such findings. Allison's position, shared by Peter, staked the necessity for and purpose of cultural production in a technocratic world on achieving a balance between opposites. The scrapbook stages a balance of opposites differently between past and present, not between gender roles. And yet, at this time, to whom did the past, as documented history, belong? In any case, sometime in the 1950s, Smithson began gluing new images onto the pages of Charles Knight's Old England, a pictorial museum of regal, ecclesiastical, municipal, baronial, and popular antiquities, originally published in 1845. This is the foundation of my talk, literally, because you are actually sitting on these two enormous volumes of Charles Knight's book that I bought in order to get closer to the text that Allison had been embroidering, as it were. Old England was copiously illustrated with over 2,500 individual engravings. Its inside flyleaf, shown here on the left of the slide, seems remarkably Smithsonesque to me, like something one would find in any number of places in the Smithson archives, but that is interestingly missing in the book that became a scrapbook. Old England was mass printed at several points in the 19th and 20th century, even as the strict separation between text pages and illustrated pages ceased to represent a cost advantage to its maker. Over the next four decades, Allison used Old England to create a new book filled with a heterogeneous array of material. The substrate of this years-long collage project recalls investigations that were ongoing elsewhere in the Smithson's practice, lithographed images of mounds like those found in the landscaping of their housing project, Robin Hood Gardens in East London of 1972, artifacts of which modern equivalents populated their buildings, tower-like fortresses and keeps resembling some of their other architectural designs, and mise-en-scene a little like medieval versions of those published with their projects for A House of the Future of 1956, or Patio and Pavilion, filled its printed and bound pages. To these, Allison added a huge image array cut from glossy magazines and other sites of advertisement, or salvaged from advertisement, or salvaged from postcards, packaging, photographs, and even the occasional architectural drawing or sketch. The massive end result is a delicate compendium threatened by the sheer passage of time. Like Allison's independent writing projects and her and Peter's thesis projects, the scrapbook is notably authored by one partner, not the family, by which I mean Allison, Peter, their long-term trusted employees, members of Team 10, et cetera, their students. And while Allison published books under her own name, this volume is intriguing because it reflects overwhelmingly visual authorship. She was working here, as it were, in her own métier. Unlike many things in the archives, the scrapbook seems to have been left alone by Peter, too big and complex and messy, and perhaps too delicate to be effectively edited when he went through the archives from the 1980s on. A private source book that shows an artist's working method and the site where new ideas were generated, its real power as a historical object may rest in the surprising range of mental associations that underpin the image making revealed here, not meant for public viewing. I'd like to emphasize the book's impenetrability and learn from it despite this indecipherability or impenetrability, keeping in mind that its most recent maker was primarily focused on the creation of buildings, objects, and spaces, as noted at the outset. This book is the paratext to a creative practice that takes place in media that differ from those that appear in its pages, for the most part. The precise sequence in which Anderson filled pages appears impossible to reconstruct. She did not work from front to back. Yet a dialogue between book and architect not only recalls Smithson projects, but suggests morphological relationships and visual associations familiar from much of their other work, as well as collaborations like Parallel. Resembling similar books by others in the IG, this scrapbook is notably more private and more unmannered than many collage works. It's at times frenetic and even a little troubling in places. Nigel Henderson's scrapbooks in the Tate Museum collections are more ordered and comprehensible, despite the evident traffic of visual ideas and influence between IG members in the early years of their association. Like Eric Revilius, Edward Bauden, and Roland Penrose, however, Henderson and Paolozzi made exhibitable scrapbooks. Allison's version is also notably distinct from the McHale scrapbook that Craig showed us yesterday. It's a private book and a thought machine, not for exhibition. It is tempting to give a shape to the dialogue between the book and its editions as time, only inferred, passed. The Smithson's reputation grew meteorically in UK culture in the 1950s and 60s, when the trifecta of Hunstanton School, their exhibitions, and the Economist Building brought them to public attention. But they were increasingly left behind by postmodernism in the 1970s and 80s, as acutely analyzed by Dirk Vandenheuvel. Rainer Banham drew the target around them, but it was Charles Jenks and a few others who hit that target effectively, silencing the Smithsons in the professional press and in contemporary histories. And it seems clear that the cause was, at least in part, this strong-minded, outspoken, talented, somewhat eccentric woman who was not content to follow the architecture pack in post-war Britain. She was, as Mary Banham noted in her obituary of Allison, subject to, quote, sudden and spontaneous flashes of genius, end quote, and she was ready to lead. The scrapbook might indicate where she would have gone, but she had the opportunity to do so. The base volume, Old England, combines pages of printed text, pages of multiple line illustrations, and plates of color lithographs. The illustrations added by Allison follow a pattern that is nonetheless often broken, perhaps reflecting rules that changed as the volume filled up. The printed pages of text host the largest number of added illustrations. These, for instance, are text pages on the left and on the right. Book's black and white line illustrations have been more irregularly and strategically replaced with one or two substitutions in many cases. Color plates like these, oh, there's another page with line illustrations strategically replaced with new illustrations. Mud brick, African architecture on the right, and a cityscape showing mosque domes and minarets on the left. Color plates like these are sometimes partially covered, as here, the coronation share overrun by three locomotives, a series that gestures to an entire infrastructure to rival perhaps that of monarchy that threads through this book in repeated images of locomotives, railroad infrastructure, or other aspects of railroad travel. Collage seems both too capacious and too restrictive a descriptor, although paper gluing is clearly used in this work. If the term collage denotes a visual or aesthetic composition of cut paper meant for presentation, very few pages in the scrapbook show any such intention. Just a few have, with one exception, which I will show you at the end, very few have cut paper, paper that's cut in a clearly intentional shape, as it were, as opposed to simply being torn or cut square. A few pages do have original materials, photographs. There's a photograph of Allison herself, a few sketches, some original text, snapshots. There's a few of those, but again, a notably limited number of those. Collections of images associated for obvious, less obvious, or entirely inscrutable reasons. These are visual notes about different sorts of relationships or just remarkable things kept for future reference. And they are not to be confused with the many orderly photograph albums kept by the Smithsons to document their travels, about which I cannot say more now. So, for example, there are pages filled with grids and lattices, as here, circles and double circles, not to be confused with heads and domes, steeply embanked buildings adjacent to wide open spaces, what the Smithsons called the charged void, perhaps. Bicycles and engineering infrastructure join the locomotives as a constant beat throughout the book. Morphological associations often appear, as in the case of cylindrical forms that don't look alike in the image, but do resemble one another's three-dimensional form. To find the connections here, one must think spatially, as also in the case of the pages that depict what I'm calling mass ornament. One of them taken from one of the original illustrations of the book itself. But this isn't really a work of collage, I would argue. It's more a scrapbook. The scrapbook is a consistent motif in the Smithson's work. Van den Heuvel writes, quote, "The scrapbook method is key to the Smithson rhetorical techniques. It's directly related to the way they collected their materials and organized their archive, where they kept lists and projects with such headings as the 1930s, the 1950s, or the materials sacred to brutalism. Relatively open-ended inventories that were always under scrutiny and continuously subject to editing," end quote. Christine Boyer, Notes of the IG, Henderson, Paolozzi, and Allison Smithson were avid scrapbook makers. Allison in particular extended her childhood habit of collective scrapbooks full of Christmas stickers to a large private collection. Here then is a compendium of images, a private store to be used either literally pulled out of the album or more figuratively in future projects. The case might rest here and the scrapbook become just another oddity of an oddly misunderstood figure. But the substrate volume continually reasserts its presence as you look through the pages. and in the process suggests another possibility. The technical term for this kind of book, and there is one, is extra illustrated. The type appeared in Europe in the 18th century, providing a way for individual readers to appropriate mass printed material, to populate books with pictures, and in the process, to stake a personal claim on them by customizing their image program to the reader's desire. Extra illustrated books have none of the disorder and visual chaos that we associate with collage effects. They constitute an orderly presentation, as you see here and here, a call and response between, or here, John of Gaunt. They constitute an orderly presentation, a call and response between an unillustrated mass printed book and a particular reader illustrator, who thus situates the book, often filling it with pictures from the present of the illustrator, not the present of the author. The form flourished throughout the 18th and 19th centuries among elites, but gradually became more popular and middle class, becoming known as Grangerizing after its controversial agent, James Granger. There's a frontispiece to one of his publications, The Biographical History of England. Their practice, the practice of extra illustration persisted into the 20th century, long after printing technology had made many kinds of illustrated texts easily available. And an example would be Hermann Marx's 1940s extra illustrated edition of Thomas Pennant's Some Account of London, originally published in 1790, which is now held or was given to the British Museum. Knight's book is an illustrated book, not an extra illustrated book. Yet there is a connection. The extra illustrated book was gradually commoditized over the course of the 19th century as the production of extra illustrations became a business in and of itself. As Lucy Peltz notes, antiquarian miscellaneous museums or cabinets appeared and began to proliferate in the 1840s, the same decade in which Knight's volume appeared. Old England may be, in effect, a mass printed version. There's some of the activity around this kind of work. Old England, another version of clipping, the destruction room, a room where you can go and cut out illustrations from books in order to extra illustrate your own book. Old England may be, in effect, a mass printed version of the extra illustrated book. Its separation of text from image pages and its interleaved color plates with facing blank pages suggest not only the economics of publishing in the 1840s, but also a book form that was both familiar and becoming immensely popular, offering not a pictorial history, but a pictorial museum. Knight pushed a step further from the extra illustrated book, but along the same path, naming his now mass printed volume after a new metropolitan space. Alison may have encountered Old England whilst working on her Royal Academy project, from which I quoted above. There she consulted a similar volume, but limited to the City of London. Pugin and Rowlandson's Microcosm of London, published in multiple editions throughout the 19th century, but reissued by John Summerson in 1947. Imposing a glossy color consumer world on Knight's already commercial marketing museum of Old England, now internationalized through global tourism and the Smithson's own networks, Alison revisited the technique of extra illustration on one of its imitators. Not as the amateur practice of elite figures like Horace Walpole, an avid extra illustrator, but rather in a shower of commercial image excess, burying the base images in a forest of new illustration. Through this forest, one threads a path laid out by patterns of association, morphology, formal resemblance, typologies, visual jokes, disasters, and more subtle forms of cross-referencing, so that the scrapbook feels distinctly networked. And I think I'm supposed to, yeah. The trails are obscure. Perhaps they await further exploration. Yet some things seem clear enough. Smithson overlaid a reproduction of Strozzi's The Rape of Helen onto the frontispiece of Old England, as if to connect this act of appropriation of a woman from the earliest mythology embraced by Western culture, the Trojan War, with the great age of British imperialism to which Old England gives precedent. What I referred to earlier as her ambivalent feminism seems to echo with the silent outrage that she evidently felt around Britain's imperial past. Two forms of incursion then, one into women's agency, their capacity to act, another into colonial holdings. One of the least well understood minds of postwar architecture situated herself in the scrapbook, I would argue, within a changing postcolonial landscape in which the very concept of Englishness, of nationhood itself, is put on display. At a time when nationalism continues to resurge, we might consider the scrapbook as Alison's record of transitory, changing national identities with images of international consumer culture covering and nearly obliterating the English source material over which she mounted them. And here's the one, what I would call collage page in the book, which is the hennaed hands of anonymous women overlaid over the funeral of Marshal Alphonse Juin, the military hero of World War II and the resident general of France in Morocco. I'd like to return to the question of collage to close. Collage, but more specifically photomontage, was a familiar tool of thought in postwar Britain. Its contradictions have been explored by others in this sequence who have cited juxtaposition, relational thinking, and mobility as motors of collage practice, along with ambivalence as a crucial response on the part of British audiences to the shower of consumer product set against war and shortage. As other speakers have shown, this cultural technique, collage, can be deployed like language itself as a tool for making and deferring meaning. The question here is what sort of dialogue the architect was carrying on with Charles Knight as the avatar of Britain and Britons, mostly male. Alison's mistrust of and refusal to use machines is well known to those who knew her and study her work, yet she saw the experiential and perceptual possibilities that only machines provided. The 1982 book, AS in DS, is one example from a long list of restrained techno-optimistic thinking. Offset printing might be another. This simultaneous belief in and mistrust of machines may also explain her admiration for the heroic period of modern architecture, often explained as a period when handcrafted buildings took on the image of machine age technology. When being modern within the existing technologies of the building industry was not yet possible, looking modern might do instead. This is at least what interwar modernists did. The Smithsons' determination to craft a substantive dialogue between machines and their human operators can be found throughout. Here it unfolds between a mass-printed book and a mass-printed book masquerading as an aristocratic product and the clipper, filer, and paster who filled it. This helps explain some of the more mysterious aspects of the Smithson practice, buildings, spaces, and objects in which machine-made things can only be described as self-consciously handcrafted. The House of the Future and its contents credited to Alison more than Peter are like handmade ready-mades, mock-ups of machine technology, complete with chairs that seem impossibly preliminary. One might ponder this quality in other Smithson buildings, unbuilt projects, designed objects, and books. As architects, they were far too professional for the unexpectedly rudimentary elements that recur throughout their practice, admittedly with greater frequency after 1970, to be accidental. Deeply skeptical of the technophilia of Banham and his crew, equally refusing the savvy, professionalized rhetorical address of Jenks and Sterling, James Sterling, or the opportunism of high tech, Alison fought a rearguard battle against too many enemies to reclaim built space from technophilia, bureaucratization, and optimization. The extra illustrated scrapbook plays out the thread of hand-to-machine connection through a multitude of juxtapositions and confounding examples. Collage here means reclamation and engagement with the things of the world as you find them. Thank you.
Thank you, Claire. so wide spanning, so many issues and questions that I've got. Thank you for that. Maybe before I start, just to remind and encourage people, you know, do if you have questions, use the Q&A box. I know amongst the panelists there are people who I'm sure must have questions amongst the participants, but maybe I might just begin. I've gone backwards and forwards of which particular question I want to start with, but I think just where you ended up a moment ago, I wanted to ask. Yesterday in one of the papers, Ben Cranfield was talking about time and being with time and raised questions of without time. And I think in that last few minutes, you raised that complicated and problematic relationship with past and present, with technology and future. But I think you said, when being modern within the existing technologies of the building industry was not yet possible, looking modern might do that image. We know House of the Future, you know, is an extraordinary deceptive. We know it's made of card and not plastic, and it always shocked me when I realized. But I wonder if you could say what the scrapbook, specifically for Alison, what you think it tells us about the tension with time, her own particular relationship, not just as Alison and Peter Smithson, but whether you learn something about her relationship to thinking through time and the relationship to science and technology that's sort of separate from their collective practice.
I think it reinforced for me that, and looking back at her thesis, reinforced for me how deeply historical she was as a thinker. That is, she had a real interest in relating the present to the past. And I hadn't been as conscious of that as I became in looking at the book. I mean, just the fact of using one of these old illustrated books about England indicates something of that interest on her part. But I think that was really wanting to engage the present in relation to the past, I think distinguishes her very significantly from many of her peers in all four of those decades, where you couldn't simply produce architecture for the contemporary market. It had to be thought through the past as well as the present. Was that distinct from the way Peter thought about history? I think they had, I would characterize and I may be going too far here because I haven't studied his writings in particular for this, but there's a kind of tactility to the book, a way of engaging with these remote things in a very material way that I associate with her. I think there's that the sort of almost weaving of these weird torn bits of paper, and even the kind of arrangement of the squares. There's a kind of woven quality to the book that I think speaks to her interests, and that you can see that in the thesis as well. This theme of fabric and textile is just kind of pulling throughout the entire thing. The other thing that I found fascinating that might answer this question a little bit is the recurrent engagement with large-scale engineering infrastructure that runs through the book. People normally would associate that with Peter, but I think the scrapbook tells us that Alison was really interested in large-scale systems. Does that provide some kind of answer?
It does, and in fact, it answers a question that Susan Seyfried had put forward, which was to say, could you expand on your concluding comments about the importance or thematic of fabric in Alison's work? But I think you've touched on that.
I think it's metaphorical and material for her,
yeah,
as we saw in that first quote.
And I think that the materiality and the metaphoric, I wondered, I think you talked and said the scrapbook felt distinctly networked. And of course, that's one way we're used to thinking, particularly today. But I think, you know, when you were pointing out all these visual and conceptual connections, but as much as and patterning and morphological thinking, ones we can easily see. But there are also many esoteric juxtapositions that I think are quite, you indicating, quite hard to untangle. And I wonder, just thinking about Craig Buckley's, some of his points yesterday about the technologies and practice of clipping and what that in relation to an information age. And I just wondered if you knew or suspected of any kind of sort of theories or arguments or ideas around information theory or cybernetics that might have been informing or influencing or shaping Alison's juxtaposition, or whether it's just her cultural thinking, her practice at that moment.
I think it's there in the sort of conception of the book, but I think she was also seeing it in the original publication, which also has some of this quality of things connecting kind of throughout the book. The arrangement of the original book is chapters on all of those categories of things: baronial, municipal, regal, religious, ecclesiastical, popular. And so the original book is kind of, in a sense, woven through. There's a sort of single network that runs through the whole thing. And I think, you know, my impression of Alison's thinking is that she's just fundamentally skeptical of confusing belief and ideology. And I think that I see a kind of continuous resistance to accepting anything that you might call the status quo. So I would think her approach to cybernetics might have been similarly skeptical. And I see the turn back to a very arcane manner of bookmaking from even as early as the 18th century. That seems to me, in a sense, to be a kind of response to the idea that networking is 20th century. There's this sort of yes, but, and I find that constantly with her work is this sort of yes, but response to sort of getting fixed on something that might prove to be illusory.
Thank you. Some two great questions just come in. So Ben Cranfield is asking, he says, the scrapbook seems such a complex object. You said that to some extent it was private, and I wondered how it related to Alison Smithson's relationship to professionalism and its gendered and colonial formation in the field of 20th century architecture. How might the private amateur practice of the scrapbook disturb that?
Well, I would say, I think Alison was highly professional, but I think she redefined what professional meant. And it basically meant running your office out of your home, maintaining a very high level, a very high standard for the realization of work, but not adopting the sort of markers of professionalization, not wearing suits or uniforms, not going to an office, not separating your children's daily lives from your professional working life. I mean, I think the scrapbook, in a way, sort of reinforces the continuity that one perceives between life and work in that household, that there really wasn't, there wasn't a distinction of that sort in terms of the wholeness of a life lived, but there's a very strong a professionalized approach to the production of things. So for example, Hans Danton, I mean, or the description that I read, I would consider that quite unusual for a 21-year-old student to be so extremely serious about a project that is certainly not about to be built. And so detailed about its realization. So I don't know if that answers Ben's question. Maybe I haven't totally understood it.
No, I think it did. I think there's also that sort of unpicking of it being a private and, you know, endeavor, you know, and to what extent. I wonder whether it's propositional, whether it's a kind of thinking through and making an argument rather than just making a commentary or a visual record. Do you you know.
I think there's a conversation going through it, and I'm beginning to get a sense of how that conversation unfolds. But I need more time with it, I think, to understand, to sort of partly because there she didn't work from front to back. And so the it's as if a conversation's happening, and she and time is running, and she rejoins the conversation over the years again and again, in the same place but at a different time. And sort of sorting that out, I think, will take a little bit more work. So there's a huge family of images that are connected to the base material. Lots and lots of images of photographs, color images of English medieval architecture, and then that gives way to other kinds of concerns. But you can see that some of those images are brand new, and some of them are older. So there's some archaeology that can happen that might be interesting.
Just looking, it's as you go, you're anticipating or engaging with quite a number of the questions. So it's a nice energy going on here.
But I'm not looking at the questions. I hope that's okay.
There was a question from somebody exactly about what kind of history and what that relationship to the image of New England was being articulated through the pages. And you, I think you've just spoken to those kinds of history of Old England, that kind of New England and Old England being put forward. And I suppose that's also something that it's not that it was contained within the original book, that she didn't go outside it, that she just keeps expanding that book because the book still is a container of meaning.
Yeah.
You know, rather than going elsewhere. Because in fact, the book could have finished, I should think, quite a few leaves in. Another question, can you read any of the pages or spreads of the scrap as a coherent work of collage in its own right, in which different images and texts are deliberately intended to be placed in dialogue by the viewer? And I suppose that does raise the question of who is the imaginary viewer other than Alison, perhaps.
Yeah, so there were a few pages, and I showed almost all of them, I think, that have you know, distinctive shaped cuts. There's only half a dozen or so. So I came away feeling as though these were experiments, you know, sort of experimental, or just kind of like, you know, like your embroidery. I mean, just something that she's working on. I mean, Soraya describes the book being around and being added to over the course of years. When I say a private source book, it doesn't mean that nobody could look at it. It just means it was not produced for public consumption. It was produced as a kind of, really, I think, an ongoing conversation about, about England in the world. I think England in a kind of global framework. So there is New England in there, there's a huge amount of non-England in there as well in terms of her additions. And one interesting exercise would be just to go back and, you know, the locomotives and the bicycles are engaging with contemporary England. Some of the visual jokes are, some of the disasters, the accidents and disasters, some of those are focused on England. But the global, you know, there's a sort of influx of folk culture, of sort of ethnographic material from other countries, that comes in on the wave of global tourism that's kind of rising in the 70s and 80s, about which she may have been quite skeptical. But that's very striking, that there's this kind of very colorful, exotic, non-English stuff laid over the English stuff. And then lots of very political images, the evacuation of the embassy in Saigon is in there. There's Reagan and Thatcher, there's Marshal Juin, as I showed you. There's quite a bit of political material in there as well that needs to be parsed more.
And that, I think that scale of flux of political, cultural and social change that the period it spans, you know, is so rich, and clearly you haven't had the opportunity yet to do anything other than just catch it and discuss it. But I think just on, as we come to the end, just a nice sort of observation Anne Briggs has made, and maybe want to comment on it about Asen's practice as a form of visual cataloguing, classification and indexing, that there's something quite almost calming about that process of classification and ordering when in a period of enormous flux and change. And whether, I think that the comment is asking really whether there's something in Alison's approach to that that perhaps was an antidote to other forms of activity and practice going on at the time. So I suppose that the kind of proliferation of technologies, practices, visual, maybe even model making, that there's something perhaps about this. I mean, if you think about the other typologies of the archive, the Smithson archive that you were referring to, do you think this represents a different approach, a different headspace, mindset?
I do think there's a kind of note-taking function of storing things, of saving things up and not losing them. So there's that for sure. And you know, there's a lot of stuff that's loose in the book that would have been waiting to be glued down or incorporated probably. So I think that's a very practical function, like, you know, like we take a picture with our iPhone. She would presumably cut stuff out and stick it in the book. So that's, I think it was the storehouse for this kind of stuff. And that is fundamentally different, I think, from the curating that's going on in the other kinds of books that they produced. So this is less curated. It's more kind of raw, I think, that stuff is added and kept, but not presented, not really fully curated, maybe gradually curated over a period of years. I would have thought this was a really fantastic storage device where you could make sure you didn't forget things by holding them.
That's great. And I know we're literally just coming to the end, but somebody had just put in a rather nice question and observation about the temporal frame of architecture is much longer, and the responsibility to anticipate whether we could bring that into the enabling capacities of the book activity. And I think there is something in that.
Absolutely. It's a great comment. Distinguishes Alison's perspective from the perspective of someone like, I think from someone like Jim Sterling, who was very concerned with immediate.
I think that's a perfect moment to end on, and to welcome back Rosie. But thank you, Claire. That very rich and always fun to go through. And we should never underestimate the playfulness of the objects we work with as much as the process itself as well.
Yeah.
Thanks so much, Rosie.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Claire and Victoria. It's such an incredible object to spend time looking at. And I think its kind of complexities and internal interconnectedness. The questions that we were getting were really kind of testament to just what an interesting object that is. So thank you so much. We're gonna go to a short break now. We'll take 10 minutes, or just nine minutes actually. We'll come back at 10 past one. So do take a comfort break, and then we'll be joined by Judah Attille, and we'll have a film screening. Thank you.
Good job, Paul.
Hello, everyone. Welcome back from the break. And huge thanks again to Claire and Victoria for such a rich and textured start to the day. I'm sure there'll be many resonances between those discussions and our next presentation. I am truly delighted to now introduce Judah Attille, who is so generously presenting a brand new film work for us here today, entitled A Considered Cut, which has been specially produced for this Collage conference. Judah is currently working towards her AHRC-funded PhD, which is entitled Africandescence at the University of the Arts, London. Her doctoral research asks how avant-garde filmmaking strategies can frame complex interpersonal narratives. Judah was a founding member of the Sankofa Film and Video with Maureen Blackwood, Robert Cruz, Isaac Julian, and Nadine Marsh Edwards from 1983 to 1988. During this time, she contributed to the events Black Women and Representation and Black Feminine, Exploring Images of Black Women, and to the debut films of the collective, including Territories 1 and 2 in 1983, The Passion of Remembrance in 1986, and Dreaming Rivers in 1988. Judah later joined the Visual Arts Forum Black Women Artists Study Group in 1995. She's contributed to numerous publications, including The Fact of Blackness, Frantz Fanon and Visual Representation, Rhapsodies in Black, The Art of the Harlem Renaissance, and Today I Shall Judge Nothing That Occurs, Selections from the Ektachrome Archive by Lyle Ashton Harris. The film Judah will present today, A Considered Cut, has been produced through a process of practice-based collective and interdisciplinary inquiry through a 16mm film workshop entitled Dreaming Rivers, Found Footage 2021. And we're also so thrilled that some of Judah's collaborators on the project have also been able to join us here in the audience and may be able to contribute to our discussions later on. So Judah, thank you so much for being here. And we will now screen the film, which is about 30 minutes long. And just to mention that initially there isn't sound on the film, but the sound does come in slightly later. So I'm now going to hand over to Shauna, who'll play the film.
This project started after attending one of Not Nowhere's found footage workshops. And that was before COVID. We were in Not Nowhere studio, we had guidance from Rhea, we had access to materials, we made our marks, we had our stuff digitized, and we were able to watch it together. So that was a pre-COVID time. And then I started talking to Taylor about 2019 about doing a workshop, a found footage workshop, but instead of a random found footage that came out of the Not Nowhere found footage bin, actually using a print I had, or an extract of a print I had from Dreaming Rivers, which meant that people were aware of the film they're working on, but still had access to the same sort of mark-making creativity that the workshop would allow. So that was a conversation that started, you know, with Taylor, went on and went on. And then, separately, an invitation came from Tate, who were holding a big conference about collage. And I put in a proposal for a workshop. I put in a proposal for something I'd like to contribute to this conference, and then they came back with a schedule for the main body of the conference, then a sort of a morning of workshops, which was much more loose and able, and people like me were able to maybe expand the idea of what collage was around filmmaking and the cutting and editing process. So at that point, I said to Taylor, well, would this be something that we could actually work towards? Would this be beneficial? Anyway, COVID came along, everything was cancelled, the conference was cancelled. Post-COVID, Tater doing the conference again, but it's an online event.
You're planning not to necessarily include Dreaming Rivers. It seems that the identity of this searching is more group. I mean, not that the individual process then cannot be embedded into the group, but it seems that it can cherish the group connections from the beginning. So that is very easily responded from my part. Mm. And then, you know, I'm already thinking, because I'm trying to respond to what, and I think that all of us, this is what we have been doing to offer to what is given in each discussion. I already have, especially because of the current experience focusing on touch, I already have in my mind how I could hold the space, navigate a more alternative exploration of the material.
So my question would be, How does a somatic intervention mediate the process of the actor at the point of making a mark on celluloid film?
I love what you were saying about movement. I've been reading and thinking a lot about errantry and how a camera might be errant, and that there's a kind of power in being able to wander. So that's very interesting to me as just a kind of aside. But anyway, it strikes me that the way that we're talking about somatic movement and also drawing as well, that scale will be very important. And I don't know, just something to think about as we, in every different section, because I'm thinking also about the way you're describing seeing film and having to make that kind of adjustment to what time means in terms of this physical thing that you see in front of you. So I think scale will be important. And just to say as well, in terms of the finished product, I was wondering, well, finished product, I was wondering what you had envisaged in terms of those little chunks. Just thinking that like 3 seconds is like a very manageable amount to work on, but it's not that much time for someone to register what's happening if they're watching it for the first time, and that maybe it should be a little bit longer. I don't know. It's up to you, of course. But also, I was thinking that to have evenly sized chunks would be really nice, because there would be a kind of standardizing rhythm to the final work that might impose a kind of like framework on all of our, because presumably we're going to make very different marks together. So that strikes me as something which would work really well, but I'm not sure if the time could be a bit longer, which brought me back to scale again, because I was thinking, well, yes, that is quite cumbersome to work on like 10 seconds on one time to see the whole thing in one go. And if it's about the process, then maybe we could do smaller chunks, but if if it's going to be better for the final thing, maybe that it would be better to do something longer. In response to like showing the process, I think that's really great. The work does seem to be a lot about how it's constructed. So I don't know, it strikes me as something really faithful to the project to see the process in the end result. Yeah, and that was it really. Those are my thoughts.
Question about what materials would be used for the film, for marking up film. So you mentioned the ink with the brush. So that would be my suggestion for working fast, because you can cover a lot by just like a gesture really quickly. And then you might have things that are kind of like quite scratchy and fine and small and slow. But yeah, I mean, is color an option? Is that something that we're talking about as well, or colored materials? This is just, it's a pen, it's a nib pen for ink. So it's just like one of those standard old school drawing things. And I don't know if this would even work because it is quite bouncy. You know, it might not be the right thing, but you know, you could possibly use, I was thinking like sometimes you can use forks for kitchen, you know, your eating tools, knives and forks and things like that. So you can use that to draw with or scratch with, and they would be much more robust, I suppose, and metal. You can also use things like stones. I have a couple of leaves here. So these just came off the plant I have in the room. But if you go outside to a park, you might be able to collect up some twigs or stones or things from outside that you can then use to scratch or transfer something or take off or, you know, whatever. So, you know, those are the kinds of mark making tools that I would normally use. But again, I don't know what would be best for working with a film.
What was the project originally for? Like, were you supposed to?
So basically, what we're doing is, so Judah Attille made a film in 1988 on 16 millimeter, as would most of the films been made. And, you know, now, so that film is now like 33 years old, et cetera, et cetera. There are, copies, it's been digitized, so it also has been digitized and re-released like on digital format, and you know, it's shown at like the BFI, it's in the Lux collection, et cetera, et cetera. She has, she was given a couple of 16 millimeter prints from like the 80s, and basically she took one of those prints and cut them up into, I think it was 5 or 6 sections, I don't remember exactly. She'll probably say on this video that we're going to watch together. Okay. She cut it up into like 5 or 6 sections, and basically what she wants to do with us is we're gonna essentially do like an extended or like an exploded version of Rhea's found footage workshops with this film. So like normally with the found footage workshop, you know, we're just doing stuff on like random, you know, random just junk from the trim bin. Mm-hmm. But actually what's cool about this is that we're basically gonna draw on like a classic film. You know what I mean? Like,
oh,
yeah. Which is kind of intense, but she's being really chill about it. Like Rhea and I were like, you want us to what? But she's super chill about it. So no pressure, but basically it's just really cool.
I mean, this is bloody cool.
Yeah.
Like, first of all, when I'm first, cause I think I was there when I picked these things up, and then she told me she was part of like Sankofa.
Yeah.
And like, she was like, you guys before you guys became you guys. So it's like quite big time lady. So I'm excited.
Yeah. She's definitely like, you know, a mentor, I think, for the co-op, like in a lot of ways. But anyway, okay. So
how did you come about meeting Judah? Don't
mind me. I think that what happened is that Noor, who you may have met, maybe not, she's another 16 millimeter filmmaker. Well, she does loads of stuff,
but Noor and Brad and James used to run Nowhere. It was in Bethnal Green. And then they basically left London. They gave, well, Brad's still in London, but they left Bethnal Green and they gave us a bunch of the equipment that's now in the room with you now. And I think that either Noor or Brad, maybe it's Brad, works at LCC where Judah's doing a PhD. Mm-hmm. And so she found out about us from there, and she's literally taking like every single class that we have done, or like every workshop. She's taken at least one of every workshop since the beginning. So she also knows like all our workshops, which is really cool. And yeah, so that's how we met her. Okay, so you open the package and let's see what's in it.
It says,
there it is. That's the film.
This is the, so this is the Sankofa film that.
Yeah. This is Judah's film, yeah.
So then once you've drawn on it, is it gonna then be digitally scanned again? So
yeah,
exactly. Open it up, keep unraveling it.
It's funny. This is what Rhea was saying. It's quite cumbersome if you keep unraveling it, but I don't know. Do you have room?
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah. So I had this thought like, oh, maybe I would just try to draw, not necessarily draw like a scene or a sequence over and over, but maybe draw some kind of abstract image and draw it like over and over and over and over so that when it gets scanned, it will like, I don't know, maybe it's just some like amoebic thing that just does this. I don't know, right? Mm-hmm. I think most people though, that ended up doing some kind of like continuous line, some kind of continuous mark. So those are kind of just two ideas, but really like, let's just watch this video and then you draw.
Then see. Okay. Yeah. I'm down. Oh, it lights it up. Okay. Well, this lady looks like she's in her mid-40s, I would like to think.
Who put her hair like that? She never wore it like that.
What did you come here for, Mum?
Ready.
All right. Okay, so we're gonna watch the video and just do everything that they say to do.
Okay.
Yeah.
Do you want me to start drawing after the video is finished, or do you want me to start drawing now?
Start drawing on your paper now. And okay. And in the video is gonna tell you what to draw.
I'm ready.
I'll try to keep it nice and sweet. So just kind of going from your writing hold, which is a normal writing hold, to playing around with something like this. So you can just do it along with me at the same time. So hopefully you've got your pencils and paper. And I like to do this one here because you can see how you can kind of make marks, and you're probably not seeing this one very, very well. You can make marks and you can make lines. So if we have the film maybe stretched out, you can do something like that. And basically your hand is off the paper. So we're not putting the hand onto the paper, but we're lifting it off the paper. And you'll also notice that the wrist is locked, which basically means that your hand is moving together with the arm from the shoulder. So it kind of gives you a bigger range of movement, a kind of less controlled movement. So it's not like a fine motor skill, which we would use when we're writing, but it gives you a chance to kind of get your body into it, I suppose, get your arm into it. So basically we're moving away from the writing hold and just kind of opening up our arms, our hands, and rotating the wrist so you have like a full rotation possible.
By positioning my hand with my palm facing the floor or the desk, without moving the wrist, was an awareness of my shoulder blade and this wing-like movement. So very, very, very softly, and to the extent that this is available to each one of us, remember all our bodies are different. Just take the hand off the one side and place it, play a little bit with your torso as well. See where you are without pushing anything, and just place it on the shoulder blade of the opposite side. And really, it's about playing and checking how the shoulder blade is not actually attached to, it's not a steady, fixated structure of our bodies, but it can actually slide. The scapula, it's a very flat, if you would like to include a little bit your imagination, it's a very flat bone that slides upon the rib cage. So check a little bit what you can get through the hand of the opposite side, while at the same time playing with this articulation. Okay, can I sense how this flat bone is actually the beginning of my arm movement? We usually tend to believe that the shoulder joint is the beginning of the arm movement, whereas the shoulder blade starts this articulation.
Maybe coming as a transition into a soft contact with the feel. What if these are different forms of skin? So we can play with these as well, with pressure. What if they're made out of tiny, tiny, tiny breathing particles as our skin, as our whole bodies, actually, the tiny, tiny breathing cells.
I am a serial collaborator and have experienced the not knowing before. I'm grateful to have the invitation to work with a new material. I never touched film before. I tested new strokes, new holds, new marks, purely for the pleasure of being in the moment. The sun was shining. I worked outdoors, needing space to stretch. I'm intrigued by collage, the merging, layering, slamming together of two things to make anew. What is the analysis, the reading of this new work? What do we see? It was disorientating. I seemed to have amnesia. My memory of the processes I executed did not correspond to the film I watched. I could not even tell which bit was mine. Naming, adding words to a visual, to a process, taps into a different part of your brain, aware of energy contained in the film and each other, questions of permission when working with someone's work.
I remember seeing her body unfurl as she very slowly moves in the fabric and folds, and I wanted to mimic the shape of those gestures with my marks. I focus on texture, pattern, and adornment in the film. It was difficult to make the first mark. I needed to know what I was looking at, and the size and scale of those images means you don't have complete control of the outcome, which is also freeing. I thought about how texture can work with a body or against it, over top of it, or moving with a body. I used my marks as a reduction too, marks to take away, to remove some of the adornment in the background or to form a kind of patina over the image. I perceived my marks as a precious experimentation. I felt the weight of Dreaming Rivers, the weight of its history within artist film and video. What a gift to be able to work so freely on a work which means a lot to me.
I touch the film, and this brings to my attention how it smells. It smells like family and family moments, moments from another time, celebrations from another time. The emotion side of the film, the emotional side of myself, the recollection of the content of the film, the family, the journey, the woman, the mother, the children, the emotions. How materials connect with emotions. The materiality of internal and external motions. How the somatic materiality of the film connects me more fully with its content.
Thank you so much, Judah. Do you want to join me on screen? Thank you so much, and thank you to all of your collaborators as well. I think it's so interesting to see in that film the way that you've kind of looped the collective process and the practice back into the work itself, and you get this kind of layering of the analog film and the digital film and the different kinds of temporalities that those films contain within them, and your kind of interventions into them at different moments in time and across the group as a whole. So thank you so much for sharing it with us today. It's fantastic to see, we've been talking about collage, but actually to see the practice unfolding over time through film is really interesting. I wondered if we might start, we'll come to questions in a moment, but I wondered if we might start, if you wanted to maybe just talk a bit about your kind of your editing strategies and your methodology, maybe both in this film that we've presented today and in Dreaming Rivers, the film that you were working with. Maybe thinking about some of those ideas around collage, around cutting, recombining, and the kind of editing of pre-existing materials.
Thank you so much, Rosie. I just want to say thank you so much to Paul Mellon, because you sort of gave us a sort of deadline to arrive at this place, you know, for this first iteration of Dreaming Rivers Found Footage 2021. So thank you to all the collaborators and Not Nowhere for making this possible, absolutely making this possible. So so the whole process, the whole idea of us coming together was to propose a workshop that was inspired by an offering by Not Nowhere, their found footage workshop, has been said. But in our thinking around how do we deliver this workshop to people who might want to come in and be part of the mark making, how do we structure the learning? How do we structure the process? And bear in mind, we were discussing this over lockdown, so we didn't have the benefit of being together. And I've worked with Christina in her studio at East 15 before lockdown, when she put on a 2-day symposium called Somatic Voices and Beyond. So I had a sense of her practice in physical space, but the other contributors just didn't. And so us talking and working together was to find out how do we make this accessible for other people. And so we decided to put ourselves through the process as a first iteration. Taylor's package didn't arrive in Amsterdam in time for her to be part of the real life marking that we did together. It got to Amsterdam, then it was sent back to the UK. So Ibrahim acted as her hands, basically. And so they worked together virtually to achieve their mark making. So the strategies are different. With Dreaming Rivers, I had a script, I had an idea. The actors were casted and they had roles to play that were predetermined by myself. That's completely different to this sort of work when you're working speculatively with people who have their own very particular practices and their own very particular way of working. So the film that you've seen is really us documenting ourselves. So me talking at the beginning is me talking to the other members of the group, being held to account. basically, and explaining, you know, the backstory to this whole project for them to consider whether they want to be a part of it or not. So it was constant negotiation. I think that enriches the project, because in that negotiation, you have to check yourself, you know, to check your own resistances. You know, when Christina said to me, so you're not considering showing Dream Rivers, my immediate response was, well, no. And I had to think in the editing, well, what was that about? You know, and include it in to reference what she was saying. And, you know, we've eventually extended the context of this presentation by allowing people to see Dreaming Rivers, for them to understand the way in which racialized bodies work as part of the narrative of Dreaming Rivers. So the strategies were different, much more discussion, not only to represent our practice as a group, but also to represent individual practices as best as I could, really. It's absolutely pleasurable. Very challenging, very hard to give up the position of instigator and author, but at the end, the reward is brilliant because everybody, you know, is settled with the outcome.
It's so interesting the way you've taken that workshop model and then have kind of adapted it for this online, you know, this more kind of COVID-induced online atmosphere that we're working in, where exchanges are often kind of mediated digitally, and as you say, having to kind of send things. But fundamentally, it still retains that kind of history and legacy of the workshop and the film workshop as this kind of space for collective practice and for certain forms of experimentation. And I think this comes across really strongly in the work.
It's wonderful. I love the workshop model. It provides intimacy, a certain intimacy of care around learning. The workshop model we use as a workshop Sankofa, we created other workshops for filmmakers to hone in their skills. Not Nowhere runs workshops, which are absolutely beautifully, you know, the mood and the creativity, the freedoms allowed within a formal environment that is open to inquiry, open to discussion, open to discovery, is absolutely brilliant. And I love the way Ibrahim talks about Not Nowhere as you guys, you know, she was you guys before you guys were you guys, and that legacy is really important. But the funding structures are different. You know, so in the changing funding model, it's like the survival of workshops like Nowhere is really crucial to experimental practices of this type.
I think it's so interesting that word care that you use, and it's such a different, the meaning of care in the context of the film that you've just shown in relation to ideas of kind of conservation and preservation and how we normally think about caring for archival materials is very much about keeping them in their exact kind of historical state and preserving their structure. And actually the way that you're talking about care in this context is more about a kind of, it's quite interventionist, and you're kind of cutting as giving care to the materials as kind of extending their life form and kind of, as you say, relinquishing a certain authorial control and kind of giving the materials over to other practitioners. It's a very different way that we kind of conventionally understand care in archival and conservation contexts.
Yes, I'm very inspired by Derrida. I think he was one of the good guy philosophers. You know, he had so many ideas. And one of the things I picked up on is the idea of not only the idea of hospitality and the uncertainties of hospitality, sort of the uncertain, the uninvited guest turning up, you know, but also the idea of the to come, you know, avenir. And I just feel so privileged that I've been able to engage with a new generation of filmmakers who have had trouble accessing work from the 80s. But when they've found the filmmakers, when they've found the material, they've invited filmmakers like myself into conversation. And I think that sort of crossing of paths, if you like, you know, me going towards the end of my career, as it were, and them coming into and reframing discussions and creating new discourses is very, very exciting. And I think that whatever happens to Dreaming Rivers as it sits in the BFI archive, I'm not so worried about now that I know that there is a generation of filmmakers who have had access to the work and can reframe it in their own considered way. And I must thank Rhea for the title, because she is the one who actually, you know, gave the critical break on what we were doing to say, we need to consider, you know, what we're doing. Because my energy was, I want to mark this film. So I think that sort of critical pause was really, really helpful.
Mm. I think we might will open up to questions in a second, and we'll invite some collaborators to join us. I know that you wanted to talk about your use of line in the film, so perhaps you could say a bit about your use of line, and then we'll open up to questions.
Just a quick one, because I think there's a sort of a transition from Dreaming Rivers and its inspiration, the inspiration it took from Sonia Boyce's She Ain't Holding Them Up, She's Holding On, and the sort of horizontal build-up of narrative of that painting. In 86, and Claudette Johnson's work, I Came to Dance, where not only does it build up, the image build up horizontally, but it also the narrative builds up vertically. And that wonderful sort of swoosh central line is an amazing representation of movement, I think. And as I was marking my film, I kept thinking about this image, especially the triangles, because in the third vertical section of the image, reading from left to right, those abstracted lines, I can't remember anybody really talking about them, and it makes me think about abstraction, especially the way in which British Black women use abstraction in their work sometimes gets eclipsed by more dominant narratives around representation and the figurative. And so I suppose with this project, as I was making my marks, I was thinking about the potential of the line and what the line could mean and how the line could link us to historical discourses around abstraction and modernism.
And it also becomes then that the line is the kind of connecting line between you as collaborators as well. It's the kind of linkage between the different hands that are touching and interacting with the film.
Absolutely.
I wondered if we might invite your, I think we have Christina and Ilga, maybe Ria, here with us today, who might come and join us for our final few minutes on screen. While they're joining us, I'll just ask you, we've had a few questions in the chat. Someone says that they love how the film dramatizes the stretching of image and speech and time that has become so familiar to us through Zoom, and showcases a new kind of jerky, conversational, exploratory, but also fundamentally disconnected kind of group portraiture, embedded simultaneously in the domestic sphere and across the channels of Zoom itself. Could you kind of talk about this, do you think, as a sort of group portrait?
Thank you very much for that observation. It's really a complimentary observation, you know, because some of the footage was never really intended for public screening because the conversations were internal. And I think that the appreciation of that domestic space within this context is quite, you know, I reciprocate that appreciation. How much material is there, do you imagine, that people have saved on Zoom from these types of conferences? There must be masses, you know, that people just saved. What to do with it. I've worked with Ajamu X for a presentation of his work to Royal College. I've worked with artist Yasmin Nicholas for her presentation for Brent when she was one of the artists at Biennale, at the Brent Biennale. So in some ways, it's become a convention of working with artists across distance and time, forced on us by lockdown. So it's just finding creative, sustainable ways to work during a difficult time.
Ilga, Christina, Ria, did you want to say anything about how did it, for you, this kind of form of group portraiture and the sort of the way that Zoom has mediated your collaboration with Judah?
If I may quickly start, can you hear me?
Yes, we can, yeah.
As Judah mentioned, I'm actually the lucky one to have had a somatic and an actual in-person connection with Judah before. And I feel that this was actually, to me in a way, a through line that allowed me to enter this collaboration with some sort of comfort. There is something about the space and the possibilities that online spaces can allow connection, you know, with different countries, but at the same time, in my understanding, nothing can actually substitute the in-person experience and the depth of the embodiment in the real life. communication. So personally, I can't wait for us to meet up in person and reconnect with the film and actually being able to come in physical contact with each other. So there is something about the possibilities, but also a gap in the online space, if that makes sense.
Absolutely. Building on that, we've had another question, which I think connects to that idea of touch, I think, and a kind of physical connection that you were gesturing to, Christina. Judah, was there a particular reason why you wanted your collaborators to interact with the kind of materiality of the analog film directly rather than sort of overlaying drawing at the level of kind of post-production? Was it the actual materiality of the analog? Because it's amazing when we see it being unfolded, you know, we're watching the digital film and we're seeing the physical film being kind of unfolded and unrolled in front of us. And could you maybe say a bit more about the 16 millimeter film and why that the kind of materiality of that was important to you?
Yes. 16 millimeter film is an analog medium. Not many people come into contact with it now. Ibrahim is a film student and he hadn't come into contact with 16 millimeter film. Ilga and Christina hadn't come into contact with it either. So it was really important to actually understand and to feel what it was like and to feel its properties and its potential for mark making, to feel its resistance to mark making as well. And it is an homage to 16 millimeter. And there are very few places in London that specialises in 16mm film work in this way. That's why Not Nowhere is so important. So yeah, it was important for me to, as a Dreaming Rivers found footage concept, to invite people in who've not had contact with 16mm film, but might have written about 16mm film, especially people who've written about Dreaming Rivers. Maybe aren't filmmakers, have never actually touched the substance, to see what that interaction might produce. So yes, it has properties of its own, and I think that people's response to it is very, very interesting. Especially Ilga could probably talk on this actually.
Yeah, I was thinking I would love to do a second round, you know, having now seen the digitized version of what I made. I have, like I said in the reflection, I didn't recognize the strokes. I knew what I did on the film. I took each segment as kind of unique, a unique kind of set of marks. But when I watched it in a film format, it just didn't make any sense to me. I couldn't recognize which one was mine. So I would love to do again, you know, kind of have that chance to kind of try it out again. And I think that word resistance as well, the film is very, I thought I was scratching a lot, but in the end, it didn't actually make any or very little scratches. So it's kind of a trial and error thing. So.
Wonderful, thank you. Judah, I know that I can see that we're coming to time now. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you wanted to just close with any final comments. We've had one last question about whether collage is a kind of inherently collaborative medium, and I don't know if that's your interest in it, perhaps.
I don't think it's necessarily collaborative, but I do think it's very impactful. I think I remember when I first saw John Hartfield's The Executioner and Justice in the 80s when I was an undergraduate at Goldsmiths. It was so impactful because there are so many injustices that were being experienced in London on the streets that it just spoke to me directly. So I think it can be a very impactful medium, yes.
Fantastic. Well, thank you all so much. And it's great to have...
Rosie, sorry, I must say, I've just seen Amna Malik's name pop up. So I must say, Amna Malik, you're one of the people we want to come in to this project because you've written and been so supportive of Dreaming River. So we'll be in touch.
Well, I'm glad this is a site for future collaboration.
Hopefully. Thank you so much, Rosie.
Thank you. Thank you very much, everyone. And thank you to all of our speakers today. It's been a fantastic kind of unfolding of the discussions over the first 2 days. and we really appreciate all of your contributions. Thank you.